Welcome to another edition of Pittsburgh Sportsline at Olive Oils Pizzeria and More, 930 Brookline Boulevard. We've got some great guests here. One guest I met in a Giant Eagle. We'll find out when it comes on. Just a couple good guests. I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. Got Smoking Jim Frazier here. He was supposed to do the Italians against the USA boxing. They're not doing TV, but I thought he was going to do shows like he did with Bill Neal. So he ended up showing up here. I'm honored to have him. This show will be rebroadcast Wednesday, 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock on Verizon 32 everywhere in the Pittsburgh area, from Cranberry, Wexford, to Nemacolin, and all points in between. Comcast 7 only in Bethel Park. If you're in Bethel Park, you can just watch it on Comcast 7. We have a lot of great fans that do that. Facebook, I'm very proud. We hit a brand new high, 6,542 likes on our Facebook page. Thanks for watching our shows and liking our pages. We appreciate that. I'm proud of that Facebook page. This show, the link will be on there. Our guests will be able to see themselves. I know they can't wait. And our show is sponsored. We have a segment called What's On Your Mind, and that's what I first asked Smoking Jim, and that's what I answer. It's sponsored by Skeets Lewandowski of Skeets Service Station. He's out there in Finleyville. Anything that runs on gas, he works on, whether it's a lawnmower, whether it's a fishing boat, whether it's a weed whacker, of course, cars, trucks, tractors, you name it. They just brought in a forge. He has a nephew that's making knives out of the forge. Then he bought some other device called a hammer to provide some extra force to make other metal instruments and things that they can use in the garage. I mean, I can't make it up. Take your vehicle there. Hall of Fame photographer Frank Favis took his lawnmower there. I took my lawnmower there, and he told me, can you pull that, press the starter like 10 times? I go, yeah, I can do it, but it just didn't start up for a first cut. He goes, just try it. I did it 12 times, it started up. He goes, hey, bring that over. I said, I'm done. He fixed my mower. See you later. That's the type of guy he is. He's an honest car mechanic, and it's well worth seeing him. I think I have a phone number for him. 724-348-4715. Just tell him the talking machine sent you, and he'll take care of you. Seriously. All right, let's start. Smoking Jim Frazier, what's on your mind?
Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. And if you want the green, you got to see Levine. If you haven't done so already, do yourself a favor, grab a menu, because last month I had the best pizza I ever had in my life, and the price is right.
It was free for us.
It was still good.
And Frank was here last time. He skipped out on us tonight. He can't even talk to Steelers, and the Steelers had a bad game like they did in Chicago. So Frank won't be here. I tried to talk to his manager to come up
here. It's Italian
day. Oh, maybe he's celebrating that.
That's right.
It's Columbus Day, buddy.
You know what? Maybe Terry Bradshaw was right when he said the Pittsburgh Steelers coaches were cheerleaders. If you look at Bill Cowher's head coaching tree, he had head coaches like Shane Gailey, Mike Mularkey, you know, Ken Wisenhunt, Bruce Arians, Dom Capers, Jimmy Haslett, Marvin Lewis, and Dick LeBeau. Look what Coach Tomlin has. He has Keith Butler. Keith Butler's the worst defensive coordinator in the history of the National Football League. Whenever Keith Butler goes cover three, every receiver runs free. Pittsburgh Steelers, cover two is not for you. I call the Pittsburgh Steelers Buster, because when they go man-to-man, the Kansas City Chiefs will treat Buster like the Indians did Custer. I'm not here to hate. I'm just shooting straight. The Pittsburgh Steelers don't want to be great. They just want to be 8-8.
Smoking Jim, it's been almost a year since I heard they don't want to be great. just 8-8. A few, couple years ago, they did do that 8-8, and we heard it ad nauseum. Look that up in your Funkin' Wagnalls. Thanks, Smokin' Jim. You did add some new material. What's on my mind, everybody knows I bleed black and gold with all the sports in Pittsburgh. Penguins start out 0-2. They come back. They won a good game against the Predators, 4-0. So thanks to the Penguins. Then I'm in shock from Sunday's game. I thought after like four games they were starting to come into their own. Thought they would learn to block a little because running backs do need somebody to block, even if they're as good as Le'Veon Bell. They need a blocker. I didn't see that. And then I thought we're going to show off the running game. Le'Veon Bell had 15 carries. I lost track after 50 passes by Big Ben, but I didn't lose track of the five interceptions that I don't know what happened. He's been throwing the high ball all year long. I don't know if he's trying to show that he's still got a good arm even though he's a little older. Just play your game, Big Ben. Then I saw him lumbering on the field to a first down and not even making a play on a couple of the interceptions. I don't know where Big Ben's head is. He started talking retirement again, and we all know he's a drama queen. Each year he would talk about it, but this year maybe he's serious. Maybe something did happen. Maybe three kids keeping him up at night. Maybe that could be, and a wife affecting him. That's what's on my mind, and we're going to start our show with our guests starting right now. I ran into this gentleman at a Giant Eagle after a show, had to pick up a couple things, and I'm in line, and Smokin' Jim, you know the talking machine talks to just about everybody. I see this nice young man wearing a Cal U t-shirt, so I figured I'd talk to him and see what he was up. I think we had a 10-minute conversation, maybe 15.
Yeah, minimum. You just all right. Started talking. I couldn't shut you up.
I know. He was behind me, so he was stuck. Please tell them your name.
I'm Joe Noro. I'm the assistant baseball coach at Cal U.
You know what? He told me that in line. I just wanted to hear it officially. We exchanged emails. Told him I'd like to have you on a show someday, and he wasn't intimidated by the talking machine at all. He just kept talking right with me. He went word for word. I think we were pretty close on that. So now I'm going to try to introduce you guys to my man here and what he's done in sports in his life. Hopefully he can answer these questions because it's all about you.
I hope, yeah.
When did you start in sports?
I think 5 was the first time I played on a team. I think I was 5 years old playing on a little
baseball,
a little Coach Pitts baseball.
Did they have a baseball in your bassinet with you?
I think they may have. Every picture when I was a kid, I got some kind of something in my
We head. Had Judge Ron Arnone on here, and his son plays baseball, and they won a championship game. And I asked him, and he said, that was in my crib.
Yeah, that's it.
So
I could
believe it.
Yeah.
So at 5 years old.
5 years old, yeah.
And where'd you grow up at?
I grew up in Aspenwall.
Aspenwall?
Yeah. So right down there, graduated from Fox Chapel High School.
Okay.
And then...
Did you play high school ball?
I did. I played baseball and basketball. So
get out. Basketball, yeah. Too.
Basketball, too.
You don't have the height like I'm used to with some of these basketball players.
No, I definitely
I was trying to be kind.
I definitely got shortchanged on that, for sure.
But you like the game.
I do. I love it.
Well, I'll tell you a story. I grew up in a basketball family. My uncle is in the Jewish Sports Hall of Fame. He was on the first... Pittsburgh Ironmen, first basketball team, pro basketball team in Pittsburgh. And my dad was a referee, also made it to the Jewish Sports Hall of Fame. And he lied to me for years, told me he was like 5'9".
Yeah.
But 3-4 years before he died, I'm looking at his military card. Mm. It said 5'7". And meanwhile, he goes, I'm shrinking. I go, Dad, you lied to me. And he played basketball. He had basketball teams with... Cyril Wecht, you ever hear of Cyril Wecht?
Yeah.
He was actually on my dad's basketball team out of Homestead that my dad organized.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been involved in basketball and sports my whole life, so I appreciate that. I took it easy on your height.
Oh, it is what it is. Because
I've interviewed one of my best friends growing up was this Jeff Werner from Keystone Oaks.
Mm-hmm.
Met him in 8th grade. He was only 6'11".
It's a big boy.
Yeah, he was big. We bonded somehow.
Sheesh.
But yeah, those things happen. Now, what position did you play in baseball, or positions?
Well, I was always an infielder, catcher, and a pitcher. Just kind of then kind of played a little bit of outfield. And then
what did you prefer?
Anything. I just like to play. I love to hit and all
that
stuff. And then
what kind of average did you have?
Pretty good.
300?
Above.
Above?
Yeah.
350?
Above.
370?
It was high in high school.
391.
It was high.
It was it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I like, it's not bragging if you did it, so right. I like to bring that out.
Yeah.
No, that's good to hear.
Right.
So you can hit that ball.
I could, yeah. And oddly enough, I went to college and my career went as a pitcher.
Get on.
Yeah, it took off in that direction.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you have some heat? Could you throw a hard, high fastball?
Not as hard as these major leaguers now, but
but you had some skills.
Yeah.
Where'd you go to college?
I went to Calhoun Community College, which is in Decatur, Alabama.
How did you even get there?
It's small. We talked about the separation with Pittsburgh.
It's 2 degrees here.
2 degrees.
Not 6 degrees.
Not six.
You can practice six in Alabama.
Yeah. So the head coach of the time.
You ended up there.
The head coach of the time was a local guy, actually, and he called me up, and so I ended up there.
And you were throwing the ball.
And I threw the ball down there, and then I graduated from the University of Montevallo. I finished up down there.
Did you really?
Yeah.
That is an interesting in itself.
It is. Yeah. A lot of winding roads kind of lead you there. And
out in the country.
Nothing but country.
Really?
That's it, yeah.
Now, Smoking Jim tells me he studied general studies.
Okay.
All right, at Cal U.
Yeah.
I said he has about 35 degrees.
Yeah.
In general, so General Sun Tzu, all these different generals. So I don't try to ask about education. What kind of degree did you get?
I got a Bachelor's of Science in Kinesiology.
Kinesiology?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
You got to study some medical terms.
No.
Here, Smoking Jim, ask him a question about his degree.
I'm glad you said that. I got a background in kinesiology.
Nice.
I was on book scholarship also, and I would buy a kinesiology book.
Uh-huh.
Sign up for a kinesiology class, buy the book because they were expensive,
yeah.
And then sell them back to the bookstore and keep the money. So I got some experience in that. But, hey, when you were in Alabama, did you get some good moonshine down there?
I'm not going to talk about that. So it was fun down there. It was definitely it's definitely a slower pace. And
did you do it in 4 years?
No, I did not do it in 4 years.
Did you play baseball for four years?
I played baseball for 4 years.
All right, I'm just checking here with eligibility and stuff.
I'm done with my eligibility, and I did graduate, so that's all that matters.
You know what? It's nice to know that, because I'm about all the education.
Yeah.
Smoking Jim started this thing, and he's my best friend from another mother.
Mm-hmm.
But I do argue with certain points. Like, he sees these great boxers.
Mm-hmm.
He goes to the parents first thing after he says, your kid's a champion.
Mm-hmm.
Do you homeschool him?
Really?
And he says it with a serious face, and he starts to smile because he goes, I would just let him box all day.
Okay.
So he could get better at this sport, because let's be serious, this kid got natural talent.
Yeah.
So I go with my disclaimer, which I have to throw out there all the time. Forget about homeschooling. Get an education, because not everybody makes it in sports.
No doubt.
Look at the NFL. What do you got, like 1,700 players?
Yeah.
That's like 5% of what's
–
they're NCAA. They don't go to school because they follow Smoking Jim's lead. So let's be honest.
Yeah.
Look at J.J. Watt broke his leg.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he had two back surgeries. Go to school.
Yeah. So we tell our guys, you know, you're going to make a 4 to 5 year commitment to us, but the school is the next 40 years of your life. So you got to make sure you make the right choice.
I like your sales pitch already.
It's pretty good.
Coach, I want to pitch.
Yes, let's go.
All right. I used to pitch back in the day, too.
Good.
Yeah. So.
How hard did you throw then?
Well, put it like this. My catcher had to have two pads in his glove because his hand was like – red meat.
How about that?
So back then in the late 60s, they didn't have the guns,
right?
You know, at the places like they do now.
Yeah.
They got them on the balls. They got them on the balls.
They do.
Now,
yeah.
The kids are throwing baseballs and they go, it was 75 miles an hour.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how do you know? And they're looking at the baseball. I just knew I threw hard, and it started in Little League.
Mm-hmm.
I was out in the outfield, and I threw a ball from center field to home plate without it bouncing. They said, hey, can you pitch?
I said, I never pitched, but I'd love to.
Right.
That next year when I was 12, I was 7-0-1 with two no-hitters.
That's a good memory.
So, yeah. Yeah.
Look at that.
Yeah. So, even though I'm an older guy, I can remember certain stories.
Yeah, that's crazy.
That's one of them. How about your pitching stories? Let me hear one. Tell me one of your better games that you can think about.
One of my better games.
It could be college. It could be Little League. It could be Pony League. It could be Federation League.
Yeah.
It could be backyard.
There was the
I know you got to have stories because all of us in sports,
right?
He makes up stories.
Maybe I will too. It's hard to make it up now. Everything's on the internet. You can't lie about things.
I'm going
to
be checking on this.
There was
because I got your name because the email.
No doubt. There was one game in college where I went complete game shutout with 10 strikeouts against Flagler, which is a university in Florida.
Get on.
And that's kind of one that sticks with me because it was a rough year as a team and personally. But
were they seven-inning games or nine-inning games?
No, we played nine innings. Okay. There, yeah.
I'm just double-checking because I remember I had 14 strikeouts in a couple seven-inning games.
There you go. No, but it was 10 in a nine-inning game. And
that's great.
Shutout, and so that's one that really sticks out to me for some reason. I don't know why.
How'd you hit in that game?
I didn't hit.
DH.
No, I didn't.
You didn't get any hits.
Very rarely in college, yeah.
Get on.
I pitched.
A good hitter like you hitting almost 400, and they're not letting you bat up. And
we're still a little low on that, but in high
school. 4.25.
No, in high school. It was good. I was good in high school. I was a good hitter in high school.
4.25.
We're still a little low.
Still low.
We're still low.
My man. One of my biggest guys in baseball who I like and should be in the Hall of Fame. Joe Jackson, shoeless Joe Jackson. He set a rookie record of batting over 400 in his rookie year in the major leagues.
Yeah.
And Babe Ruth copied his batting style, among others. So it's a shame that he didn't read or write.
I know.
And he got caught up into some things. And he had a good series.
He did.
I mean, with the White Sox, before they become the Black Sox, if he threw the game, he did the opposite.
He did a bad job.
Yeah.
Yeah, no doubt.
Because I've read his stats, and when I heard about him and saw these movies, I was like, how can a guy who plays the game like he does be like that?
He played like his hair was on fire all the time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
Looks like your hair's on fire. What happened, buddy? Any other game that you recall?
No, there's nothing.
They're all a blur because you just went out there every day.
You just played.
When the coach told you to play, you loved it.
Yeah, you never said anything else.
You just had a joy for the game.
Yeah, I loved it ever since I was little. So, and that's why I got into coaching.
5 years old and plus the playpen.
Right.
Anytime. I got you.
Anytime I can. So.
Definitely. That's wild. Do you have any brothers and sisters?
I've got one sister. She lives in Allentown with a nephew and another one on the
way. Glad it's named after me.
How about that?
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. So I just have one sister, though.
Oh, okay. Did she play sports?
She played a little bit of everything growing up.
Well, it seems like your family was dabbling in that.
We just dabbled.
Yeah.
And then.
How about your parents? Were they athletes?
I think my dad more so than my mom.
Okay.
I think he kind of played everything growing up, too.
So he passed that on?
I like to think so, yeah. He didn't pass on his height, though. He's about 6'2".
Son of a gun.
I know.
The heck, I'd look up to the guy.
I do, too. Every time I see him.
I kid people. Like, nah, that's pretty cool. And now all of a sudden you're a coach, assistant baseball coach at Cal U. I know you went to Alabama to play baseball. Now you come back home to coach here. How did that come about?
I was coaching a junior at Calhoun that I played at. And I saw the job opening come open, and I knew the program had a great history. It's a really good university, and it's close to home. I was down there for 9 years in Alabama.
9 years?
Yeah, so it was a chance to come back home and be close to family again and a really good opportunity to coach here. And luckily
– You set up the interview, and what'd they do? They said you're hired.
They set up the interview, and I interviewed, and then
– They didn't get back to you?
No, luckily they did, and I got the job, and I was like, let's go.
Get
I was
on.
Pretty excited.
How long have you been at Cal U now?
Not even a year yet. I started last November.
Oh, I got a newbie here because of smoking Jim Frazier.
Yeah.
I saw the Cal U shirt you're wearing.
Yeah.
Glad you're wearing that free gear they give you.
Everything costs off.
Nice shirt. Nice shirt here tonight.
Yeah.
You're repping pretty good.
Good.
I like that. And what do you coach at
Cal U? I'm the pitching coach.
Get on.
Yeah.
You went back to what you love.
Went back to it. So...
How's your pitching look?
A lot better this year. Well,
of course, you took over. Well, you had to teach him some fundamentals. Come on now, it's not bragging.
No. I think we'll be really improved this year on the mound, and our offense is pretty good.
You got some guys that can hit like you did in high school.
Better
than 450.
Better. We got some guys who got a chance to put up some runs, and we'll stop some people this year, which will be nice.
Get on. Yeah, that sounds good. So you're optimistic. When does your season start?
Middle of February we start playing games, and we'll run all the way through about the first or second week of May.
Oh, okay.
And then we'll go.
How many games do you play?
50.
50 games?
50-game schedule, yeah.
Now, I know it's a disadvantage to be up here in the north with the weather we have. We've had some mild winters, so maybe you'll luck out like last year.
Last year was really mild. But
because the southern boys like you were back then are a little bit ahead.
Yeah,
because you're playing ball all year.
Yeah, you're on the field all year round. You know, we have to go into the gym and do things like that here. But the thing is, everyone's dealing with the same thing up here.
So you're equal.
So we're equal. So it's not a big deal. Everyone's dealing with it. You just got to make the best of it.
I understand. But some are at different levels with how far they've gone with what they needed to learn.
No doubt. So you just hope when they go for Christmas
break. Depends on how hard you work them.
Well, when they go home for Christmas break, you got to trust them that they're going to do what they're supposed to do.
Because it's all year round now.
That's it.
You look in pretty good shape yourself.
I try.
Can you hit the ball?
I can hit it still a little bit. I play some softball on the weekends every once in a while. Yeah, just for fun and try to do things like that.
Slow pitch.
Oh, yeah. I'm not doing that.
Forget that fast stuff.
Forget the fast stuff. I still like to play basketball and things like that.
Do you?
Yeah.
You've matured.
I like to think so.
Okay. In my eyes, from his progressionist stuff.
Yeah.
No, it's pretty interesting. What do you look forward to being a coach at Cal U?
Everything. I think the whole athletic department is heading in a great direction, honestly. I work with
Smoke and Jim, you hear this?
Yeah. Our workers really good people.
Do you?
Yeah, it's
do you want to mention your head coach or any other coaches? Because I'm about the PR for the things.
Yeah, absolutely. My head coach, Mike Conte, he's been there for 21 years.
Wow.
He's as good of a person as you'll ever meet.
Ask him if he knows Smoking Jim Frazier.
I will. I'll ask him tomorrow.
Because everybody we've sent up there doesn't know who he is. He was captain for 3 years, got hurt.
Okay.
And he posted a picture. And his number was 22 in this picture, and it was a Cal U uniform, and they wouldn't say what year it was.
Right.
So he keeps his age a secret here.
No one's.
He likes when they say in the 30s, but
there
he's not in his 30s. I'll vouch for that.
Yeah.
We'll find out there because, you know, I even went to Buffalo Wild Wings in Monroeville, and they had Gateway jerseys up there.
Not his.
No, 26 was his then or something. They didn't have 20. His number changes. Depends on the story. Oh, sorry. I let this slip out. No, he's my brother from another mother. He makes it easy to bust his chops.
There you go.
But that's what we do. No, it sounds like a great program.
Yeah.
Athletic director there. Do you know? Did you meet that guy? Because I like the
lady.
A lady.
Yeah, Dr. Karen Herpy. She's outstanding to work with.
Get on. Because I like these programs that are more progressive.
Yeah.
That have opened it up because women's sports is growing and growing.
Absolutely.
That's what Cam Newton said.
That's a lie.
And our associate athletic director, Jenny Morrison, also.
Okay.
So they're really good to work with, easy to work with. And
good.
Yeah, so it's been really good.
Well, you've been there a year, and you're throwing compliments out like this.
So the first year's been really nice.
Can't beat it.
Can't beat it.
Welcome back home. Any other story or anything you want to tell? What happened in Aspinwall?
Aspinwall's a great little town. I love it. My parents still live there. My grandma still lives there.
They have pizza like this.
Not like that, no. They got a good place, though. I won't mention it. Casa del Sol is a really good pizza place down there, no doubt.
He never heard of it.
Yeah, that's the spot down there.
Well, you're at Olive Oil's Pizzeria. Yeah. We saved you one more
Which
slice.
Is also good. The pizza here is really good,
Definitely.
Too.
Definitely. We thank Frank Finero for having us, having great guests like this that I could talk to. I'll get out of here.
I appreciate it.
Hey, it was a pleasure.
Thanks a lot.
Welcome to the show. I've known you for a few years.
Yep.
Could you tell us your name?
My name is Andy Anderson. I manage Stout Training Pittsburgh, both our locations in Strip District and in Cranberry now.
Okay.
And I've fought MMA for for 5 years, do jiu-jitsu, wrestled all growing up, and...
When did you start doing this stuff? What
jiu-jitsu,
age?
Jiu-jitsu or just sports in general?
We're doing a show, Gary.
Jiu-jitsu or sports in general?
We are. We're on TV right now. I just met him yesterday.
Oh, he's nice.
A new friend of mine.
Awesome.
He said he'd stop by. Thanks.
Nice. I started wrestling
sport,
when I was 12.
Yeah.
Sports in general.
Muay Thai might have been a little later.
I didn't do much Muay Thai, actually.
Be honest.
Seriously. I mean, I trained Muay Thai a bunch for my MMA fights, but I've never had it. I had one Muay Thai smoker, actually.
Get on.
2012,
This
is funny. I had a Muay Thai smoker and at what is as was now Mark Cherico's martial arts on Campbell Run Road.
Yeah, I'm familiar with the place.
Yeah, it used to be Fight Club Pittsburgh.
Yes.
And
what a facility.
Yeah, it's nice. But
what happened?
I won the fight. I got the guy hit me with about it was our first fight that we've had under sanctioned rules, like me and my opponent.
Sure.
Really nice guy. His name's Tony White. He's fought a bunch of times. I think he's undefeated in sanctioned Muay Thai, actually.
Really?
That's
impressive.
But I think he was new to throwing knees. I got hit with a bunch of low blows.
Wow.
Low blows.
Wow.
Yeah, so
Smoking Jim believes in that in the boxing ring.
Yeah.
Because if you can't come back from
if you can't come
blow,
back from that, then yeah.
What kind of guy are you?
Yeah, hit all three rounds. So that was
you're kidding.
That was fun.
That could hold you back. Yeah. Okay, getting back to when you were a kid.
Getting back to when
kind
I was a kid.
Sports.
I played.
Because you seem athletic.
Yeah.
Wiry.
I played baseball a little bit when I was really young. When I was really young, like all through like kindergarten and stuff, I really liked playing baseball. Played football for a couple of years here and there. Ran cross country to keep my weight down for wrestling. I wasn't really into any sport I played until wrestling. Until wrestling, right?
Okay.
Once I started wrestling,
when did that start?
When I was 12, and it was awesome.
Yeah.
So
maybe like eighth grade.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Because I had
I tried it for 1 year.
It was fun.
Yeah,
it's fun.
Yeah.
You know?
Then they told me you had to cut weight and stuff.
Yep.
I said, forget about that. I like to eat.
Yep. Oh, I like to eat too. I could eat. I mean, I just tried to eat half that pizza.
I know. You did well. I saw it.
That last slice and if Smoking Jim.
It was like three bites.
Here, I'll take it after the interview. Yeah. I don't want to eat with a.
Well, he was eating and talking. That's why I take the mic away.
That's true. Yeah, exactly.
You know?
We don't want to take the mic away.
We have certain rules. We'll let you continue to talk.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, so
thank
you weren't really serious till wrestling.
Till wrestling, yeah. Because I got into wrestling. I was.
What weight were you at then? Can you remember?
Little. Like, I was. So I was born with cerebral palsy.
Okay.
So I. And I liked other sports, but I'm relatively athletic for being able to.
But you
do
had
what
some limitations.
Some limitations.
I never knew that.
What I liked about wrestling was it forced me to it was all on me. I didn't have to wait for a team. If a teammate messed up,
you had
up,
to work hard.
I had to work
to
hard
improve.
To improve, exactly, and that's what I liked about it.
Did I get that pretty good?
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely. When I started, I was little. Like I was 70 pounds when I started in seventh
You're
grade.
You're kidding.
Yeah, I wrestled.
Hold on. What do you weigh right now?
Maybe 150.
Yeah. I was thinking fought, 140 there.
I fought, 135
okay.
In MMA.
All right.
I wrestled 133 and 141 in college.
Did you?
Yeah.
Where'd you go to college?
Niagara Community College in Buffalo, New York. Grew up in Buffalo.
Up near the falls.
So, yeah. Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. My head coach, he was my club coach in high school. He asked me if I would he's like, you want to wrestle in college? I'm like, yeah, absolutely.
You were fired up.
I was super fired up. He was also Rashad Evans' first college coach. Yeah.
Get on.
Yeah.
That's
he
so cool.
He wrestled at Niagara and then transferred to Michigan State.
Oh, get so, on. Wow.
Yeah, and then from there, I guess he got into MMA. So
yeah.
all my coaches growing up in high school and stuff, they all knew him and everything like that. So
really?
that's what got me into MMA a little bit.
So it was like a community.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, it definitely is. It's
you
a,
guys
it's a
could all
community.
Relate to that, talk to this mm-hmm. stuff, learn from each other.
Exactly.
Do your thing.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, that's so great.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, so you got a background.
Got a background.
You had to work hard because mm-hmm. of cerebral palsy.
Yep. And then once I was
how is that with you now?
I mean, I make it work.
Okay.
I make it work.
Well, you seem like a positive guy like I am.
Yeah.
Forget about these things. I don't care if people
exactly.
are having a bad day.
Exactly.
We all have bad things happen to us.
Yeah.
What
keep
are you
a positive
doing
mindset.
Now?
Yeah, exactly.
That's
exactly.
what I want to know. How do you overcome it?
Yeah. So, after I was done wrestling, I played rugby actually for a little while.
That's a tough sport.
That's crazy. It's a crazy sport.
I know some rugby guys. Yeah. They're tough guys.
They're nuts. They're nuts.
Now I know you.
Yeah. I liked it. It was fun, but it wasn't the same as wrestling. And then I kind of did some research, started getting into jiu-jitsu, and from there started fighting MMA and stuff too. Yeah.
So you found jiu-jitsu at an advanced age.
Yeah. Not
in your
20s. In my 20s, yeah.
That's not bad.
Yeah, in my 20s.
And did you take to that pretty well?
Pretty well. I started competing my first year doing jiu-jitsu. Did a bunch of jiu-jitsu tournaments. I still do jiu-jitsu tournaments too. I'm kind of wrapping up the MMA side of things of actually competing, because I'm getting into promoting. Like the state won't let you compete and promote.
Oh, jeez.
It's a conflict. It could be a conflict of interest. It could be perceived that way.
I would think so.
You know. So, but I'm still competing in jiu-jitsu a whole bunch.
Yeah.
And that's a lot of fun. But
looks like you enjoy it. For
yeah,
sure.
It's fun. But what Definitely. I'm excited for this card this November coming
November
up.
November 4th,
Ross Township Community Center. We have a crazy card. Yep. I know. I know Dan Bogan's going to talk a bunch about it too. But
we'll get to him.
We'll get to him. Yeah. So we got right now. We got 8 fights lined up. I'm looking to get another 4 or 5 more. We have a ton of good fighters on this card.
Drop some names. Because some of them have been on this show.
So some of the fighters on the card, they're mostly, it's all amateurs, so they're mostly newer fighters. They're making their debuts, first couple fights, but they're coached by like some of the top people around here.
Okay.
Like we got guys from Stout Training, obviously.
Of course.
They're gonna be cornered by our crew, David Reese, our head Muay Thai instructor.
Hold it, wait. We're gonna have a guest November 13th who's gonna be in the corner of one of your guys.
Yeah, Jamie Chesney. Yeah, so she's actually Jamie's corner, and one of her teammates, Jill Bell, is actually fighting somebody from Stout. That's gonna be a really good fight. Marissa Barr Hartman versus Jill Bell, that's gonna be an awesome fight.
Get on.
Then we got guys from Cherico's fighting. Dan Cuddle will be cornering those guys from Cherico's.
Dan's our man.
Yeah, so I can just go down the whole card actually if you want
to?
So far. Yeah.
So I'm excited for you.
Chase Boyd versus Julian Flannery. I'm really excited for this fight because these guys are both they just made their MMA debut, and I saw the video of their MMA fights, and they just throw bombs.
Really?
They're 185 pound guys, and
they're some big boys.
They're just big boys, and they just throw hard. They're both younger guys. Chase Boyd, he's from Fusion Fighting Arts. Julian Flannery's from Clarion MMA. Then we have Maria Valdez. She's from Bang Muay Thai Austin. One of her teammates, Megan Ciccone Frazier, she used to train up here in Pittsburgh.
You're a kid.
Originally from Pittsburgh, so she wanted to bring a bunch of her teammates up for the card. So we're like, yeah, absolutely. So she's
why
fighting,
would you refuse?
Yeah. So she's fighting. So Maria's fighting Whitney. I hope I get this name right. Peguinot from Lombard.
Sounds right to me. Peguinot.
Peguinot from Lombard MMA in State College. Then we have Chris Merritt versus Mikey Hewitt. Chris is from Stout. And then Mikey Hewitt is from Wright's Gym, Pittsburgh Muay Thai. I know he trained with Dan Kakuta a bunch too. Judo Dave Shim from Shim's Judo.
Yeah,
he's
I
fighting.
Know him.
Yeah. Dan Bogan knows him really well. He's fighting the Raging Asian David Shim. He's fighting Mark Liebach from Top Tier MMA. Mark was on our card last year, and it was a slobber knocker of a fight he was in. Yeah, it was nuts. One of the bloodiest fights I've seen, actually. So it's
wow.
These fights are crazy.
They throw down.
They throw down because they're all amateurs. And I'll go through the rest of the card and explain a little bit more of that. Junior Romeo Payano from Cherico's Martial Arts. He's fighting Mike Basilevac. All right.
Very good.
I need Dan's help with some of these names sometimes because he has experience. Marissa's fighting Jill, who's being cornered by Jamie Chesney. And then we got Joe Hogel versus Joe Doan. Joe's from Stout. Joe Hogel's from Stout. Joe Doan's an independent guy, which is...
You're kidding. That's rare.
So it's rare now. Like, but guys without gyms, and they're just tough dudes. They just go in there and fight.
They just want to win.
Yeah, exactly. And then Daniel Choi from Cherico is fighting Michael Craig from Bang Muay Thai Austin also. I'm looking to put together another 4 or 5 fights because we want like 13, 14 fights.
So you're matchmaking to get this stuff together.
I'm promoting the card, selling tickets, everything like that. The fighters sell tickets
too.
Could
you do me one favor?
Yeah.
You have a poster.
Yeah, I do.
Go get the poster.
I got a poster right over here. Thank you, Dan.
I'll hold the poster.
All right, that's the poster right there. So, You can just find it right on Facebook, Iron City Muay Thai. Look for Iron City Muay Thai 2. Then our website is eventmmamuaythaijiujitsu.com. I'll put that up on Facebook.
That's a mouthful.
That's a mouthful. Because...
And I can talk.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. So just search Iron City Muay Thai 2 on Facebook. It's on Instagram. You can buy tickets right on our website. You can buy tickets actually right on Facebook, too. So that's really cool.
Really?
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah. But like I was saying earlier about these fighters, what's awesome is these
We'll leave that setting right there.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
I'm glad to be able to promote it.
Absolutely.
I like the timing of this for November 4th.
Yeah.
Sad to say, but we're doing boxing November 4th at the Bronson House.
I heard about that.
Yeah.
That'll be
PA.
Good. That'll be good.
It's a historic site.
Nice.
They got some great boxers out there.
All right.
Great
yeah.
Gems, too.
Yeah.
But this is fantastic
yeah.
for yours. Let's
so,
get back to yours. Four or five more fights
yeah,
you're looking
what's,
for.
What's crazy about these cards is they're what makes them so exciting is these are all amateurs. So they're just out there getting experience. They're going to fight hard because
there's no quitting their game.
There's no quitting their game. And the adrenaline hits you. It's your first fight. You go. I mean, that's
Smoke and Jim and I announced boxing.
Yeah.
We see like three rounds. There's three rounds in your
yep,
fights.
Three rounds.
How long do they last?
Three minute rounds.
Now, we see the first round.
Yeah.
These guys are in good shape.
Oh, yeah.
Then we see the second round,
mm-hmm.
and one of the two guys or whatever starts to slow down.
Mm-hmm.
They're not doing the road worker stuff.
So what's
what happens?
You know what? Last year, honestly, we didn't see that. It was everybody was in great shape, and they just went at it for three rounds most fights.
Right.
There were a few knockouts, a few finishes, but most of them were just
brutal.
Three rounds of just war the whole time. It was
yeah,
awesome.
That's
it was
good
great
to hear.
It was great.
I enjoy what you do and
yeah.
others do and the hard work that
oh,
you
yeah.
put in because it's a daily grind.
It is. And that's and I think that's what a lot of people that watch combat sports, like not just Muay Thai, not just MMA, not just boxing, but any of them. Like a
Can you explain
person.
Muay Thai?
So Muay Thai is if you've ever watched MMA, you've seen stand up. That's Muay Thai. That's the easiest way to explain it to somebody that's it's the national sport of Thailand. And you can throw strikes with kicks, punches, elbows, and knees. A big part of it is clinching, where you can wrap them up and just knee them in the side.
Or lower.
Elbow inside.
Or lower.
Or lower. Sometimes it happens.
I heard rumors of that.
Yeah. Sometimes. but...
No, I just wanted that explained.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we understand.
So,
I've learned mixed martial
it's
arts.
Really, the cool thing about Muay Thai, and I know a lot of people in mixed martial arts, they watch MMA. They don't necessarily like it when they go to the ground because they can't understand what's going on with jiu-jitsu. Because jiu-jitsu is pretty – it's very complex. Like jiu-jitsu wrestling, if you're not well-versed
in the sports – Tell us a
little
bit about it.
About wrestling or jiu-jitsu?
Jiu-jitsu.
Jiu-jitsu, it's – you're looking to control your opponent
By certain moves that you make.
By certain moves that you do, you're there. So it's based on the idea of a positional hierarchy. The better position you have, like if you have them mounted, like you're on top of them, that's one of the best positions. If you're on their back, there's almost nothing that they can do to you,
right?
To as far as like to hurt you. It's really good. I mean, it's a great position in MMA. I know both of you have seen a ton
yes.
of fights finished there.
Yes, we have.
Yeah, yeah. So And when you're on somebody's back, there's nothing they can do to you, and you can do whatever you want to them. So,
and it's a grind. It's hard work to get out of that move.
Exactly.
Because we see the exertion that people have mm-hmm, to put in mm-hmm. and the effort.
Yeah, exactly. So what's cool about Muay Thai is it's all what the casual fan likes about MMA without the ground stuff.
Okay.
So it's all stand-up.
I just wanted you to explain
yeah.
and clarify.
Yeah.
Muay Thai is
oh, yeah.
a different.
Oh, yeah. It's a little bit different than boxing. I love boxing, though, too.
Well, we talked boxing before Smoke and Jim got here.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
He's
no.
a huge fan of
boxing.
Yeah,
I love boxing. We're actually just getting our we just got our USA club license for our gym.
USA boxing. Because
we want to get our amateur guys doing some boxing experience and stuff, too, before they get in the cage for MMA and stuff. Get everyone really well-rounded. I think that's really smart. Thing to do as far as like do a lot of jiu-jitsu tournaments, do a lot of boxing fights, do a lot of Muay Thai fights before you get in the cage.
Well, I notice you're keeping people active.
Yeah, that's what we're trying to do.
And that's what I like about it because some people wait in sports
yep.
a month,
you can't do
two
that.
Months,
can't do
3 months.
Yep, you got to stay active. Yeah.
I wanted to bring one thing up. Like Smoke and Jim and I had a disagreement about Mayweather and McGregor.
Okay.
My favorite fighter is McGregor.
Yeah.
I told him he wouldn't beat Mayweather. Go with money because the boxer wins.
Yep.
I think I had it McGregor winning 7 rounds, Mayweather winning 2, and one even when the referee.
Yeah, 7 rounds for McGregor. Seven rounds. I had rounds one through three,
yeah,
maybe 1 through 3, and I think and Mayweather I think was just
toying with him,
playing into his game. I mean, you've never seen Mayweather fight like that before, where he was just throwing bombs the whole time.
I noticed, being the boxer, he was actually aggressive.
Yes.
Which I told him was shocking, but I only saw 3 rounds for McGregor.
Yeah,
when he was doing this thing with the fist in his face,
so
he befuddled him.
Mm-hmm. So what I was actually at the same time, I was extremely impressed with McGregor for him to be able to
you made his night.
For him to be able to go from never boxed before to boxing the best boxer, arguably
of our generation,
the best boxer even ever. Definitely of our generation, arguably ever, and be able to last till the 10th round with him, that's pretty impressive. I thought it was going to be over in 3 rounds. So
I had to get your opinion.
Plus,
because he's an expert on McGregor.
Yeah.
I kid you not.
Yep.
He's actually serious because I show what an idiot I am. He said, I'm watching it at Duke's Rib House and Grill. You want to meet me there?
Yeah.
I figured it's free.
Why not?
I come in, it's $25.
Wow.
And I stayed.
See, hey, it was a billion-dollar fight. They had to make their money some way, right?
They got some off of me. I'm sick to this day.
Yep.
I still haven't recovered. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think McGregor's good.
I wanted
to get your
thoughts.
He's not the best ever. The best ever MMA fighter just fought this weekend. Demetrius Johnson.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Okay.
Him that well.
So, he threw a guy midair, caught him in an armbar. That's how he finished the fight. Seriously.
That's impressive.
Look it up online.
Wow. What's
that? Mighty Mouse Johnson, the UFC 216 that just happened on Saturday night.
Wow.
Look up the finish for the title fight.
He's
co-main event.
He's giving you direction, Dan.
For the co-main event.
We'll bring
event.
You up in a few minutes here. Let's see what we got here.
He caught him, threw him midair, caught him in an armbar. So he's the greatest fight. 11 straight title wins.
Did you say 11?
11 straight UFC title wins.
That's impressive.
Yeah. He broke Anderson Silva's.
I don't care what he says over here.
He broke Anderson Silva's record.
Wow.
The record was 10. He broke it. 11 now. So
thank you for your insights.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
We're going to be wrapping this up. What
else
do you have here for us?
Yeah. I got to
see more notes.
Oh, yeah. I got to thank our sponsors, Dark Star Gear, Stahl Plumbing and Drain, Thompson Gusick Insurance Group. They're all helping sponsor November 4th, Iron City Muay Thai, Ross Township Community Center.
Great.
We got tickets starting at $30, ringside for $40. Beer vouchers are available for $5. It is a municipal building, so you got to prepay your beer vouchers.
Little stipulation there on that.
Tickets will be available at the door unless they're sold out. We had a big run online tickets today, so buy them.
Hold it. You got the Talking Machine endorsement. Buy these tickets.
All right. I'm
Get
glad
more
we got
tickets.
The endorsement. Absolutely.
You got it.
So, and what I'm really excited is all of our sponsors. They were with us last year. They're coming back again because our big thing, like I was talking to Al about before the show, we don't want just people to give us their money.
You don't want one-hit wonders.
Exactly. I want to help small businesses get customers through our Muay Thai show, not just. Yeah.
You're going to have fans. About how many will you pack into this community center?
Couple hundred. I'm thinking next show.
There's a couple hundred people that wouldn't have known about
exactly,
this place.
Exactly.
That's how I look at it.
And I'm thinking next show we might have to go to a bigger venue because we just keep growing.
Let me tell you, you'll be going to a bigger venue.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
After this gets out, this will be out Wednesday night, 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock.
Ryzen Channel 32, right?
32 in the greater Pittsburgh area.
All right, yeah. So just a couple more fights I want to run down.
Go get them.
Oh, yeah.
Come on, man. You're on the street.
So we got a bunch of local fights coming up. This is this fall is just like local MMA. Like if you want to watch fights, it's going to happen. September 21st in Akron, Ohio, AJ Wilkins and Artem Mikiev fight. That's Saturdays from now.
Yes, October.
October, yeah, you're right. It's not.
We got to correct you.
Sorry.
That's all right. One mistake.
Got knocked out my last fight.
You might have some concussion issues.
No.
You already got the lower cup issues.
Exactly. Yeah. Then November 3rd, the night before in State College, This is going to be crazy. I completely forgot about this. Dan Bogan will talk more about this too, but
yes.
November 3rd and 4th are Pittsburgh Combat Sports Weekend. It's November 3rd in Bellator. Mike Wilkins, Don Mazzotta, Francis Healy, Chris Dempsey, Ethan Goss all fight at the Bryce Jordan Center at State College at Bellator 186.
Wow.
Phil Davis and
this is at Penn
and
State.
Ed Ruth, Penn State alumni, are fighting on that same card. Yeah, this is going to be a good card. So then the next night, we got Iron City Muay Thai, and then November 22nd in Erie, PA, I forget the name of the promoter, but Jonas Rubiano is making his U.S. pro debut. Wow. So he fought professionally in Canada in January, and now he's finally coming back to the States, finally fighting locally again. He has a huge fan base, so I'm really excited.
Glad you tapped into that.
Yeah, I'm glad we're getting him back in the cage here soon in November. So, we'll have, and then hopefully I'll be able to next my next show probably soon after that. Not sure
yet. Hey, we'll call you back on.
Absolutely, thank you.
I can't thank you enough for the information.
Very much, Al. Yep.
It was great, especially when you were a young kid, 12 years old in the wrestling.
Oh, yeah.
Appreciate what you
do. Thank you.
And all the things you do with the athletes.
Thank you very much. Now let me get that last piece of pizza.
All right. Give them that piece.
All right. There we go.
Go Buffalo.
Go Buffalo Bills.
Tell them who you are.
Hi, I'm Dan Bogan.
Welcome to the show.
I've been here once or twice before. Close to 20 times, not exaggerating. Close to.
We only
15.
Got, I looked at the clock, about 12 minutes for you.
Wow. It's a long time for me. Usually I get 30 seconds.
Well, I just wanted to pump you up a little.
First, it's always a pleasure. You always feel fine when you're on the line. It's a pleasure being in this general,
I need a drink
in the proximity of your greatness, in the geographic proximity of greatness. I got to tell you, you look very much like a guy I see Saturday night into Sunday morning on Channel 11 on the Championship Chase. There's a guy on there. You look very much like a twin brother of yours.
We all look alike.
Do you? I've heard that.
How about all the weight he lost? That quadruple bypass, they drained 47 pounds of fluid out of him.
Is that right? Is that really happening?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You're looking good.
Yeah, the quadruple bypass and the 47 pounds. He gained 2 of it back.
That was just a minute ago.
Hey, sorry.
I haven't had that. Olive Oil's Pizza, it's my first time here. And I'm going to
ask Andy how it is. Look at it.
I'll gladly pay them right after the show for a pizza to go. I'm taking one home. And you guys have, if you say it's good, I'm taking one. It's done.
It's better than good.
I'm going to make sure you stop out and visit. We're here on
930 Brookline Boulevard.
I haven't been on Brookline Boulevard for 30 some years, and I'm going to come back again, even if you guys won't have me back on your show after tonight.
Let's see what you say.
Well, yeah, let's take this one sentence at a time.
Yes.
Anyway, I'm going to be ring announcing for Andy's fantastic event, Iron City Muay Thai 2. He had me for the first one, and for some reason had decided to have me back. But no, I do want to thank you very much. You have no idea how much I appreciate being a part of your organization. As you know, I do a lot of mixed martial arts and stuff. But the mixed martial arts industry in Pittsburgh has kind of gone into remission a little bit. It's in mothballs.
We noticed.
I mean, it used to be between Pinnacle Fighting Championships, Gladys of the Cage. You'd have sometimes 8 to 10 events there, and then King of the Cage has come in. Well, it's in a little bit of a hiatus, maybe a regrouping stage. I don't know, whatever. But thanks to him and a little bit of boxing and some other things, thanks to Andy Anderson, though, he's keeping me involved, and I appreciate being involved in it. And like what he was saying, if you like MMA, we don't get that much of it other than King of the Cage maybe 2-3 times a year. This is the closest you're going to get come to the show. And I do like the jiu-jitsu and the wrestling and grappling. But
Muay Thai?
But is it – no. Let me get
you don't
to
like
that.
The Muay Thai?
No, I do. I'm saying
– I'm checking with you.
No, it can –
He missed it.
As a casual fan – I'm coming back to it. I'm circling around.
Okay.
As a casual fan –
I got worried.
It can get a little bit like you get in the mountain garden and you can get a little tiring. Now, the referees are getting good about, you know, standing them up. But if that's the part that bores you and you want to see striking, this is the show especially to come to. I mean, I've seen a guy get an elbow to the throat. I've seen knockouts, like not technical knockouts. I mean, X's for eyes, canaries flying over the head knockouts. I mean, drag them out by their ankles knockouts. And a lot of people think this is Pittsburgh Muay Thai 2, but this is the third event that the USKA has actually sanctioned in Western Pennsylvania. The first was helped by Colleen Martin Berg up in the Butler area.
Butler.
This was about 2013.
How's our friend doing?
She's doing well. The gym is in remission also. It's in storage, and maybe someday we'll go again. But she's doing well. But the USKA sanctioned that fight, and then they came back. And the USKA is co-sanctioned by the State Athletic Commission and the United States Kickboxing Alliance. They come out of the center to slightly eastern part of the state, and they are just an amazing group of people. They've been doing this for decades. They've done this not just over there. They've done this in Canada. And Irv Althaus is the commissioner, president. He does a fantastic job. He has Jen Heffentrager as his key, his number one matchmaker.
Thanks for dropping these names.
And they bring out now what to me, we have our referees in MMA. Chip Snyder is the best.
Yeah.
Very close second, Big Bill Bookwalter. They're the best. Yeah. But they bring out Gary Grant Jr. He's done every fight in Pittsburgh, and I heard he's coming for this one. Fantastic referee, does a fantastic job. They bring their guys, and it's also co-sanctioned by the State Athletic Commission, which, of course, the Honorable Greg Serb is in charge of that, and he runs a very tight ship. No one will argue that. But we've got some great local commissioners, Rick Steigerwald, Ron Rusitano, Mr. Rusitano.
Friend of our show, Rick Steigerwald.
They're all great people, and they all keep this, make sure the events run legit, run down by the book. The matches are fair. They're run clean, and they do a great job.
And they have a doctor ringside.
Oh, of course. Absolutely. Oh, yeah. As well as ambulances, everything. This is
just
all.
Just thought I'd mention that because yes, we're worried about the safety of the fighters.
Safety is always first, yes. And you know, when in doubt, and like a referee sometimes, you say, oh, he stopped that fight too early. And even I sit at ringside. If there's ever a mistake to make, it's in stopping it too early. But also, I've learned from speaking with them, they see into the eyes of the fighter that I can't see looking up or you can't see looking. When they see the eyes roll back.
Great point.
And there's even 3 or 4 seconds of moments where your lights are out and you're not able to defend yourself, it's always better to stop it. And even if they're wrong, that's a better mistake to make than being – and I'm not saying that these guys make – it's better – I know in the main event title fight, that's a hard pill to swallow, especially as a guy that's trained it. I'd like to see them myself. Give them – when in doubt,
yeah,
give them more.
We
but
always,
you don't want to see anyone brain dead in 4 years or, you know, concussed like
– Yeah, I understand that. He's my friend. We can talk about them slightly, but you always see the fighters when they call a fight.
You don't want anyone punched.
No,
yeah.
But you see them arguing.
And I don't blame them, too.
Just because they're competitors.
Yeah, and they've busted, like the fighters for this event. They're going to go out. They're going to
bleed.
They're going to sweat. They're giving their life. They're giving their life up to fight an opponent for us to watch. They're giving their all. They really are. And they don't
well
want it,
said. Well
they don't
said.
Want it stopped because of, you know, hey, I look groggy. I wasn't groggy. I was playing possum.
Or
I was,
so
know,
what
I
if they're bleeding?
Well,
if they're
if
bleeding
you're
nonstop.
Covering, if you're covering up. Or, you know, if you're defending yourself, that's different. But when in doubt, I'd still rather see it stopped a little earlier.
After 10, 12 punches in a row to the head.
Yeah, that's maybe time to start thinking about.
A little backing off there.
Now, that's a great story I want to tell you about last year's show, what a great event this is. And I'm becoming, now that I've done two, I think I can't say that I no longer like MMA better than Muay Thai. I think it's a dead even. If not, I like Muay Thai better because of the sudden of the striking, the battles, of, you know, just that viciousness, this, you know, the explosiveness of a knockout or a knockdown or whatever. And their main event, you got it was Vince Meng against Ethan Hayes. Hayes, right?
Yep.
And Ethan Hayes, Bill Bozzi,
yeah.
Uniontown Fight Club. He's been on the
friends
show.
Friends of ours
and,
have been
and,
on the
and
show.
Bill Bozzi is a stand-up guy. And every
I
fight,
second that emotion.
Every fighter he's brought for any event, male or female, they've come, they usually win, and if they don't, they make the other person pay to win that fight. They always, he doesn't bring an unprepared fighter, and they always come prepared to win and do battle, and they always do, win or lose. And they brought, and I'm telling you, this main event, 3 rounds. First 2 rounds, Vince Meng and Ethan Hayes, when I say it was a coin toss, it was a coin toss. The third round, they're still going at it, and as it comes to the end of the round, they're trading blows, everyone's, and it finally, Vince Meng kind of gets the upper hand and puts him between the ropes and is hitting him. And the ref turns and waves it off as the bell rings.
Wow.
Now, you say, okay, well, so what? It's over. No, wait a minute. The first 2 rounds were so close that if the referee stopped it after the bell rang, you got to go to the judges' scorecards, even though Vince Meng may have won the fight. And, I mean, they had to go to literally a half a dozen people's handheld cell phones at the fight to determine that the bell, and it turned out the bell did start to ring before the refs threw
get on.
And we had to go to the scorecards. Now, correct me if I'm wrong. I think it was a split decision or split decision. Vince Meng won it.
Yep.
But that, I mean, talk about what a great fight and just what, how that's a tough fight to lose. I mean,
awesome.
That was just, I've never seen anything like it. You say, well, the fight was tough. He should have won. Well, he won the last round maybe, but those other two, coin tosses, that was so exciting. Just waiting.
Thanks for sharing that story.
That's the kind of stuff you're going to see at this kind of event.
November 4th. Right. Buy your tickets.
Get them in
you
advance.
You get to hear this guy.
Well,
you get to verify
despite that,
what
despite
Andy
that,
Anderson said.
And like he said, there's some people from the MMA industry that I've worked with before. Mike Basilevac will be there. And then in the main event, the Raging Agent, David Shemp. And
he's I know told, him.
He said, I said, you know Racket Discipline. And despite that being a racist type, no, he's a good guy. We're friends like that. And he's bringing it.
I'm glad
it,
you
and,
only got a couple more minutes to talk.
And he's fighting Mark Leibach. That's going to be – that has on paper the possibility to be every bit last year's main event was, if not more. And, of course, Jill Bell.
Andy's second in what you're saying.
Jill
He's
Bell, I don't know Jill Bell, but I can't wait to see her because she's got Mike, what you talking about, Willis in her corner, and none other than Pittsburgh Sportsline Hall of Famer, inaugural class, Jamie Chesney, training her and in her corner that night. So that should be a fantastic night. Handsome Jim Aljay from Steel Nation MMA is supposed to be there. He's wow. given this an endorsement. We should see Dan, the Bionic Fist of Justice Kakuta. He's got fighters there. Mark Cherico. We better. Yeah, Mark Cherico is supposed to be there. There should be a ton of awesome people there.
We will miss you guys because we're going to be filming and announcing boxing.
Well, that is such a great weekend for fighting in the Pittsburgh area because, like he said, on Friday night, watch it, Bellator fights. We've got the Ethan
hey,
the Wolverine.
We would be there if we didn't have a prior commitment.
Ethan Wolverine Goss on Friday. Chris, the champ, is here. Dempsey's fighting for Bellator. You got Dominic the Honey Badger Mazzotta out of Lower Borough. He's going to be there. Iron City. Mike Wilkins, the general of the Wilkins Army, is going to be there, and none other than Francis Mad Dog Healy all on that card.
That's my man there.
That's a great show. And
how
after you watch that.
How many people do you know that are engineers and fight MMA?
Yeah, nuclear, right, wow. nuclear. So wow. that's on Friday in
Penn State. Set it on our show, Smoking Jim.
Watch it on TV. If you go to the fight,
he
if they bring
concussed.
A ticket, if there's tickets at the door and you bring a ticket from that fight, there's some sort of a deal for you, right? $10 if the show's not sold out, and it might be, but if it's not sold, if there's tickets available at the door, you have a ticket from Gowanda State College, you come back the next night to the Ross Township Community Center, you get $10 off our ticket to see our fight. And
that's a deal.
Outstanding, is it not?
We're going to have to wrap you up here. What else do you got to say?
Other than that, all I want to do is...
go for it.
Handsome Jim knows that...
Get it out.
I DJ a Thursday night somewhere.
The
Gateway Inn. I'm sorry, Smoking Jim. Smoking Jim knows about the Gateway Inn on Route 8's wing night. Stop out. A friend of yours that used to be the chef at Atreus at the stadium, never boring Loring West, is our cook. He does the wings there now. Oh. And we've got our bartenders, Chelsea, Rachel, and what's that?
Where's Anna?
She was supposed to come tonight, but Anna didn't. Anna had other, and she was
busy.
Yeah. Yeah, I think she didn't want to come with me. Anyway, but she was supposed to come. But that she doesn't work at the Gateway. She used to work at. She's out of the business now. But and also the Mac Attack, Tracy Mack. Of course, I want to say hello to my puppy dog, Samson.
Excellent.
Samson, the best person I know in the world. My sister, Paula.
He can
Furman.
Watch this as we wrap up this show.
And a happy birthday to the greatest of all time, the living legend of professional wrestling, Bruno Sammartino, on October 6th, turned 82 years old. Happy birthday, champ. The greatest of all time.
Yes, sir.
Thank you guys so much.
I agree. Thanks, Dan. Thanks, Andy. I got to close this show out with how we always do. Stay Joey strong.